G'day, my name's Dave, and welcome to my YouTube channel. If you haven't been here before, we do advanced mechanics tutorials. And we've been doing two-stroke series for a while. And for the last couple of months, it's been winter, the ski season down here in Australia. And I've been skiing, as I do every year. So I've been sort of busy doing that. But now the snow's kind of melting because it's getting warm, and we're going to get back to it. At the moment, I'm still working on the two-stroke expansion chamber calculation software, and I will get that done in due course. But what we're going to do is a couple of side videos in the meantime. Now, this is a question that you may have posed or may not have posed before, but has been mentioned in videos on YouTube. And that is, the question is what is the maximum engine RPM limitations? That is, what is the thing that stops the engine revving any higher, or what determines the maximum RPM of any engine, essentially? Now, for all intents and purposes, in an engine, a single cylinder engine, let's say a motorcycle engine, we will assume that the crankshaft is of sound construction. And all other things being equal, no other parts of our engine are going to fly off or fly apart or break. And I may go into some of the various modes of failure that we can encounter with engines. But essentially, the limitations of RPM on an engine, or how high can you rev your engine, comes down to the parts of the engine that are reciprocating. That is, the parts of the engine that are going up and down, not the parts going round and round like our crankshaft, okay? Now that comes down to when a single cylinder two-stroke engine without valves, our reciprocating part is our piston. In a four-stroke, that will be our piston, and it will also be our valves, which also go up and down. So in other words, reciprocating meaning they go up in one direction, they stop, and then they go back in another direction and stop and back and forth. Okay, so that's in reciprocating motion. And parts that move in a reciprocating motion, obviously, or maybe not obviously, but the parts that move in a reciprocating motion are the ones that have some weight or some inertia behind and have a resistance to deceleration, or a resistance to stopping, and of course a resistance to being accelerated in one direction and then stopping and being accelerated in the opposite direction. Now with the engine, how we determine the maximum RPM of the engine in the engine is the piston, and what we refer to as the mean piston speed. Now, for most engines, that will be a figure of roughly 25 to 30 meters per second. So we can work out the actual mean piston speed of our engine with a fairly simple equation. And what we have here is our equation, which is 2 times our stroke in meters. So we have to take our stroke in millimeters divided by 1,000 to get our stroke in meters. 2 times our stroke, because our stroke moves in, our stroke moves down from the top to the bottom and then back up again, so it moves 2 strokes, multiplied by our RPM, and we want to turn that into revolutions per second, because we want to have meters per second, okay? So we just say 2 times our stroke in meters multiplied by our RPM, or revolutions per second, gives us our figure. So you can immediately see here that a smaller engine of 100cc with a 50mm stroke, 50mm bore, that is a square stroke and bore. The bore is the same as the stroke. At 15,000 RPM, we'll have a mean piston speed of 25 meters per second. You'll then be able to see if we've got a bore of 100 millimeters and a stroke of 100 millimeters, and then we've got a total capacity of 785 or 786 cc or thereabouts. At 15,000 RPM for that engine, our mean piston speed is at 50 meters per second. Now that goes beyond our 30 meters per second, which is probably our absolute limit. So a more realistic RPM we would have for a single cylinder engine, keep in mind that's for just one cylinder, a bore of 100 mil and a stroke of 100 mil, would be to achieve the same piston speed as our 100cc engine of 25 meters per second at 15,000 RPM. For this engine, we can only rev it to 7,500 RPM. Okay? Now, why is it limited by the maximum piston speed? Okay? Well, some people may believe that that is down to the weight of the piston. But that is not the case, because the piston is securely attached to the conrod via the bearing, and there's no free play there. But where there is an amount of free play, or an amount of slack, if you will, or lash, is at the piston ring gap. So what can occur once we start accelerating the engine to very high RPMs is the maximum piston speed will not come down to the weight or the size of the piston so much as it will come down to the actual weight and size of the piston ring. Now, as you can see, in a bore of 50 millimeters, we'll have a piston ring that's a certain size and weight. Double the size bore, we'll have double the size piston ring, which will be about double the weight. Okay? Now, what occurs when we go beyond the limitations of our piston ring, because our piston ring is the ultimate maximum RPM limit, is our piston will rise to the top, and this represents our piston ring inside the groove. I've exaggerated the clearance here because there is some clearance, but when the piston is moving upwards, the piston ring is against the basic land, okay, which is the bottom of the slot in the piston. This is the piston, and this represents the cylinder wall, okay? Now, as the piston rises up towards top dead center, the ignition fires just before top dead center. Gas pressure represented by red arrows. Gas pressure rises rapidly as combustion begins, okay? The piston's still moving upwards near top dead center. Gas down the side of the piston here pushes the piston down against the piston ring gap land. And gas also pushes in from behind the piston ring, forcing the piston ring against the cylinder wall with greater force than just the actual spring tension of the piston ring against the wall. So the force against the wall is also from the gas behind it. But when we get to very high RPM, what can happen is that once the piston stops or decelerates to a stop, due to the weight of the piston ring itself, if we've got a very large and heavy piston ring, the piston ring can actually jump up off the land. So in other words, our piston stops, but our piston ring keeps moving. What happens when our piston ring keeps moving is our gases can now escape below the piston ring. Okay, so our gases can escape here, and our gases can also escape down the front because we've no longer got a pressure of gas pushing the ring out against the wall. So our rings can unseat from the land and from the wall. Okay? At the piston gets to the top, all right, as the piston gets to the top, obviously there's a point where the ring itself decelerates to a stop. And then we get the next stage where the gas pressure continues to rise with combustion. Now our piston starts going down. Our piston ring has now gone back down and landed on the land at the bottom of the slot. Gas pressure is sealed from escaping down the bottom, and gas pressure is rising, and it forces the ring downwards, and it forces the ring out, and the ring impacts the sidewall and the land. Okay, so it slams against the wall and it slams against the piston land. All right. This continually happens, okay? At every cycle, at very high speed, the piston gets to the top, the piston stops, the ring keeps going, jumps off it, the gas blows past, it loses pressure off the wall, the ring stops, gas pressure is still rising, combustion is not complete yet, the ring then slams back down on the land and out against the wall. This continues and this cycle is referred to as ring flutter. And this is the ultimate maximum RPM limit of the engine, is the piston ring, not the piston itself. So eventually this continues and eventually causes failure of the piston ring and damage to the piston ring gap, as you can imagine, because the piston ring's jumping up and then slamming back down on the land and into the wall. Piston ring cracks in pretty quick order. And in extreme cases, it can actually knock the whole crown of the piston off, separating at the piston ring gap, at the piston ring land. All right, that's in extreme cases, but otherwise it will just basically crack the rings. So that's where we've reached the maximum RPM of our engine. So what can we do to alleviate this? Well, one of the things is we could have thinner rings. We could have a smaller ring. So the problem with it, with decreasing the size of the piston ring to make it lighter, so that it doesn't, it's not as prone to actually jumping off the top of the, you know, of continuing to keep traveling with momentum of weight, is that we'll have a very thin contact patch on the cylinder wall. The ring will do two things. It will wear very quickly, but most importantly, there will be a very small surface area between the cool cylinder wall and the piston ring, and less heat will be transmitted away from the cylinder, okay, away into the cylinder wall from the piston ring. Now, the piston ring transmits quite a bit of heat through the ring away to the cool cylinder wall, okay? The piston is not, the piston has a barrier of lubricant between it and the wall, whereas the piston ring is hard against the wall, suffice to stop gas pressure. So heat's transmitted away from there. So if we have a very thin ring, we'll have a problem with the ring getting hot. We'll also have a problem with wear. So to overcome this, we can use what's called a Dykes piston ring, and that is an L-shaped piston ring, all right? Now, the benefit of the L-shaped piston ring is, as you can see, it's got still got quite a large face on the actual piston ring, which gives us good thermal conductance to our cool cylinder wall, but the piston ring, the rest of the piston ring, is still quite small in comparison to a completely rectangular ring, okay? So the L-shaped piston ring gives us a lightweighter ring, and the lighter the ring is, the less prone it is to ring flutter, jumping off the land and losing pressure. And it's got a nice large area against the cylinder wall, so it transmits good amount of heat and it doesn't wear out prematurely. And you'll find these are very common in high revving two-stroke sprint cart engines. Rotary disc valve intake engines and reed valve engines that rev in the quarter in the order of 16 beyond 20,000 RPM, and we'll do it all day long. And obviously these are single ring pistons, okay? Now there is quite a bit of difference in the amount of friction at very high RPM with one ring and two rings. So in a racing environment, you know, we use a single ring piston. For longevity, in road-going engines that don't rev as high, then we would just use two standard-type piston rings. Now, that's for a two-stroke engine. And a two-stroke engine, for this reason, because the piston ring is the ultimate arbiter of maximum RPM, two-strokes have the capability of revving higher than four-strokes. Okay? Now, I'll just qualify that. In the past, older engines, or older four-strokes, did generally have an RPM limit that was quite a bit lower than two-stroke engines. But in more modern engines, four-strokes now rev quite a bit higher than they did. There's a couple of reasons for that. One reason is that the precision of machining is considerably better than it was back then. So the tolerances have improved, and therefore we can have higher revving engines simply for that reason. But the secondary reason is that modern engines have multiple valves. And as you can see with the old two-valve cylinder head, we have one large valve, and obviously one large valve has more weight or more inertia, and will have a propensity to bounce off the cam and perhaps even clip the piston at a fairly lowish RPM. Whereas when we put two valves or more than two valves per cylinder, okay, we have the inertia is split up into two, so the weight is halved. So we've got two smaller valves. So obviously there won't be as much inertia in a smaller valve, and you'll be able to rev it higher without it actually bouncing off the valve. So as you can see, a multiple valve doesn't just increase the amount of breathing space or area by having multiple valves. That's one function that it does, but it also allows the four-stroke engine to rev a lot higher because each individual valve is much lighter than a single cylinder engine. So that's why a single overhead valve engine, overhead cam engine will rev lower than a multi-valve engine. And that is the reason why, is because each valve is lighter. And as I spoke to you before, as I mentioned before, the valves are a reciprocating part. So they also have that same problem about accelerating, stopping, and then accelerating in one direction, in the other direction, and stopping at very high speed. Nevertheless, the valves are still a limitation for maximum RPM. The next limitation with four-stroke engines is also the actual crankshaft bearings themselves. Now, most four-strokes have a shell-type bearing, which is a good bearing, lasts a long time, withstands a lot of pressure, and is pressure-fed via oil galleries in the crankshaft and lubricated. Whereas a two-stroke is, as you know, is lubricated not by pressure-fed oil. It's lubricated by oil in the fuel, which comes down into the crankcase and lubricates the bearings. But nevertheless, a two-stroke will often have needle bearings, and needle bearings in a cage. Now, needle bearings will operate at higher speeds than shell bearings. That's the bottom line. However, needle bearings do have a limitation, and the limitation for speed on needle bearings is not actually the bearings themselves, it's the cage. So the cage in ball bearings and needle bearings is the weak link, okay? Easy to manufacture, easy to install, but for higher speeds, what we have is a crowded type roller. That's where we actually remove the actual cage. We have no cage at all. The problem is the crowded rollers, this is not a crankshaft bearing. This just demonstrates what I mean by crowded rollers, and by that I mean the rollers are actually next to each other. Rollers, you actually have to pack the rollers in there and put the thrust washers each side of it, so it's a little bit difficult to assemble, whereas the roller with the cage is easier to assemble. Nevertheless, a crowded roller will operate at a higher speed than a caged roller because the cage is a weak link. That will do it for now. If anybody's got any questions about that, put them in the comments section. We can do another video of this and cover any questions that anyone's got. I'll be happy to do that. If you haven't subscribed yet, please do subscribe. And to everybody who has, we've now made just over 2,700 subscribers. And you are legends. You are champions, each and every one of you. Thank you, thank you, and thank you again. That'll do it for today. And if you like the video, please hit the like button. And please share the video. I appreciate that. And yeah, we'll catch you soon. Bye now.